Hello students, welcome to today's English class. Today we are going to discuss the topic Toasted English, an essay written by R.K. Narayan. I am Rupna Ravindran, Assistant Professor of English, Government Degree College, Chevalla in Rangareddy District of Telangana State. So this topic, Toasted English, is part of your UG textbook, English in Use, prescribed by Osmania University. So coming to the topic, let us discuss about the writer R.K. Narayan. The full name of R.K. Narayan is Rasipuram Krishnaswamy Narayanaswamy. He was born on 10th October 1906 and he died on 13th May 2001. R.K. Narayan was born in Chennai in a working class South Indian family. His father was a school headmaster, and because his father had to frequently get transferred for his job, Narayan spent his childhood in the loving care of his grandmother. She taught him arithmetic, mythology, and Sanskrit. He was very much interested in English literature. Narayan completed his education in 1930 and briefly worked as a teacher before deciding to devote himself to writing. So his writings, most of his fictional works, revolve around the fictional town Malgudi. Malgudi is a semi-urban fictional town that he created in South India. So he is one of the most widely read fiction writers in India. He is considered as one of the leading figures of early Indian English literature. His first novel, Swami and Friends, published in 1935, is an episodic narrative recounting the adventures of a group of schoolboys. So even this is set in the town Malgudi. He has published 60 books in his writing span of 60 years. Besides 15 novels, he wrote numerous short stories, essays, and also an autobiography. He is one person who made Indian literature accessible to the people in foreign countries. His writing style is simple and modest. In most of his writings, he portrays the peculiarities of human relationships. Narayan came from a humble South Indian family background, and his writing style is graceful, marked by genial humor, elegance. And after finishing his graduation, he decided to stay at his home and write. So some of his notable works are The Guide, The Financial Man, Mr. Sampath, The Dark Room, The English Teacher, A Tiger for Malgudi, etc. He also published shortened modern prose versions of two Indian epics, the Ramayana and Mahabharata. He has received several accolades for his literary works. To mention a few may be Sahitya Academy Award, Padma Bhushan, A.C. Benson Medal by the Royal Society of Literature, honorary membership of the American Academy of Arts and Literature, Padma Vibhushan, etc. He was nominated to the Rajya Sabha in 1989. He was also conferred honorary doctorates by several universities like the University of Mysore, the University of Delhi, and the University of Leeds also. So here we have to read the essay written by R.K. Narayan. The essay is titled Toasted English. It is taken from Narayan's collection of essays titled Reluctant Guru, published in the year 1974. So in this essay, R.K. Narayan records some of his impressions of America During her stint as a visiting professor at an American university in 1969, he notices how Americans have adapted the English language to suit their needs and how, as a result, American English is different from its counterpart. So in this particular essay, he discusses about three different kinds of English, variants of English, one being the British English, the second one is American English, and third one he talks about the need of developing a specific Indian English, which has a Swadeshi stamp on it. So even America was earlier colonized by the Britishers. So that is how they got the English language. But after throwing out the American, after throwing out the Britishers from America, they have retained the English language with their own specificities. According to their own requirement, they have molded the language. So to mention that, he is using the word toast. So they have toasted the language, they have changed it according to their needs. He concludes the essay by underlining a similar need to evolve a form of English that respects the norms of the language and yet responds to our cultural context. So it was written, this essay was written in 1974 when we didn't have a specific Indian English. Now we have an Indian English molded through several years. But then during that time, he was talking about a need of, about the need of a Bharat brand of English. So let us read the essay and let us try to analyze. So let us read the essay and let us analyze the essay. The essay titled Toasted English, written by R.K. Narayan. So let us read it paragraph by paragraph and then discuss about the topics in that. In the American restaurants, they call for toasted English, referring to English muffins which, though being made in America, now retain English as a sort of concession to their origin. So we have already set the context in which R.K. Narayan is talking about the toasted English. English is actually the language of Britishers. So it is the Britishers who have brought English even to America and to India during their period of colonization. So even after getting independence or even after gaining freedom from the Britishers, Americans have retained the English, the term English, along with muffin. So they don't call the muffin, that kind of small cake, American muffin. They still call it English muffin as a courtesy for Britishers. The same may be said of their language too. Americans too went through a phase of throwing out the British but retaining their language and letting it flourish on American soil. So Americans have thrown out the British from their land. Britishers are no longer allowed to administer them. They have been thrown out and America has gained freedom. But even after gaining independence, Americans have retained their language. But it is not the actual language of Britishers that they have retained. They have customized the language and have changed according to their needs. And now the variant is called American English. It is no longer called British English for them. British English is used in United Kingdom and American English is used by people in America. The resultant language is somewhat different from its British counterpart. It is different with respect to the vocabulary. It is different with respect to the spelling. It is different with respect to the usage of idioms, phrases, and everything. Even in pronunciation, there are differences. So it may have gone through a process of toasting. So the British English in America has gone through a process of toasting, a process of molding, heating, and then changing into a more favorable form of English. The last line in the paragraph, One noticeable result of this toasting is that much of the formalism surrounding the use of English has been abandoned. So one noticeable result of this toasting or this molding is that British English was very much formal and it had so much elements of formalism in it. But when it was adapted by Americans, they have reduced the amount of formalism in it. So American English is more casual. In America, they have freed the language from the stifling tyranny of passive voice. So Britishers use it very formally. So they use passive voice occasionally, but Americans have freed the language from the tyranny of passive voice. American English is more direct. They use active voice as far as possible. So they don't use passive voice. Examples are given by the writer. Where we would say ceremoniously, trespassing prohibited. So that is a sentence in passive voice. So that kind of signboards are used in Britain. As I noticed in the parks of Berkeley, merely say, newly planted, don't walk. So in America, they don't use the passive voice, but they use the active voice. So what do they say in America? Newly planted, don't walk. So that is an active voice, very direct, and there is no need of any confusion or ambiguity. Or absolutely no parking, leaves no room for speculation. So in American English, there is no room for any doubt, any question, because it is very much direct, it is very much clear, and you don't have any doubt in your mind. And no motorist need spend too much time peering out and studying the notice. So when you go through the highway, you find this signpost and all. So these signposts are not confusing in America because they use very simple language in active voice. But on the other hand, in Britain or in United Kingdom, the language is very much formal and it is very difficult to comprehend the signpost over there. So which language do we follow in India? In India, we follow the British English. Most often we follow British English in our education and all, but in certain MNCs which are operated by the American officials, they follow American English. But majority of us follow British English. In a similar situation, our authorities are likely to plant a 20-line inscription on the landscape to say, under municipalat so and so, this area is received, etc., etc. So even in India, we use British English. So our writing, our official writing style is also very confusing. It also uses passive voice. So that is not good, and it is not easy for an ordinary person to comprehend that kind of English. So we have to learn something from the American English, because American English is very direct, very clear, and they use only relevant words. I saw many American office doors, just do not enter. So if you don't want any visitor to come in, Americans directly say do not enter. The traffic signs at the pedestrian crossings never mince words. So even on the traffic signs, you find simple English boards which say go or wait. You don't have any difficult terms used there. In a Hollywood studio, I was rather startled to read Mark Stevens' Keep Out. Mark Stevens is a busy television personality who did not like to be disturbed by visitors. Incidentally, it left me wondering why, if Mr. Stevens does not like interruptions, he should announce his name at all at the door. But it is one of the minor mysteries that make travel through the country so engrossing. So you have to be very concentrated when you are traveling through Britain, because the signposts are so confusing. They have passive voice, very elaborate sentences, and you have to digest it and then drive accordingly. So your travel through the country of Britain is so engrossing. Coming to the next paragraph. The toasting of English has been achieved through other means also. The first process of toasting was that they have got rid of the passive voice formalism. And now, what is the next step of our toasting that they have gone through? Americans have evolved certain basic keywords which may be used anywhere, anyhow, words which have multiple purpose use. So, Americans have evolved at certain keywords that can be used beyond their dictionary meaning. So, the writer is giving certain examples of these kinds of words. One example to mention is check. So, if you if you go and look at the meaning of the word check, the dictionary gives only one or two meanings. But in American English, this check is used in different context. But that is not the case with Britishers. Britishers use it only according to the dictionary. They don't follow other usages. So, in America, the word check has universal multi-purpose use. Coming to the text, I may make it a point here. I may make my point clear if I mention the example of the word check, which may safely be labeled the American national expression. So, check can be called the American national expression. While the British usage confines it to its bare dictionary definitions, the Americans uses it anywhere, this expression being so devised that one may blindly utter it and still find that it is appropriate for the occasion. So, Americans use it every now and then that it has become their national expression. I will check means I will find out. So, it can be used in different contexts. To simply say I will find out, in America you can use the word I'll check. If you are going for an investigation also, you can use the word I'll check. If you are going to examine, scrutinize, verify, probe, so the intensity increases. So, even in all these contexts, you can use the word check, I'll check. You can use the sentence I'll check, and you can use the word check in all these contexts. The intensity of the investigation doesn't matter. It is understood by the listener. You check means your ticket, token, or whatever you may have to produce. So, if somebody says you check, then what is the meaning of that? It is about your ticket, token, or something, some document that you have to produce to him. Check room is where you leave your possessions for a while. We say in India clock room. So, that is check room in America. Check girl is one who takes care of your coat, umbrella, or anything else you may leave in the custody. So, one who is there near the clock room is called check girl in America. Check in and check out. At first, I heard it as chuck out and felt rather disturbed. Chuck out means you throw out somebody from there. That is the way they pronounce. But check in is you get admission in a hotel. So, it refers to one's arrival in a hotel, and check out means your departure from there. And there are scores of other incidental uses for the word. If you are ever hard up for a noun or a verb, you may safely utter the word check and feel confident that it will fit in. So, even if you mistakenly utter the word check, it doesn't matter because it has that many meanings in America. So, that will fit in. The word will fit in any context. So, next he is talking about another word, that is fabulous. So, fabulous is another word that is used in that country freely without much premeditation. So, even the word fabulous is used in America without much of a thought. So, it has enlarged its sense in America. So, it is not tied up to the dictionary sense, but it has varied usages. I found a lady in Wisconsin declare, "Oh, those cats of mine are fabulous." So, that means they are eccentric. But if you are talking about a person, oh, so he is fabulous, that may mean anything from a sincere compliment to an insinuation that he displays a mild form of charming lunacy. So if you are talking about a person and then you use the word fabulous, that means that he is lunatic, he or she is lunatic. You might have understood. So these are the two words that can be used in different contexts apart from its meaning given in the dictionaries. Another example is okay. It is the easiest sound that ever emanated from the human vocal cord. So it's very easy to utter the word okay. Everyone knows how comprehensive its sense can be. Okay is a self-sufficient word which needs no suffix to indicate any special respect for the listener. So you can just utter the word okay and the listener understands what you meant. So you don't have to give any suffix to the word okay. You don't have to add okay sir, okay madam, like that. If you just say okay, it is understood in America. It can stand by itself without a sir to conclude the sentence. In this respect, it is like yeah. So another word that R.K. Narayan is talking about is yeah. That is also very easy to utter. It just seals off the sentence. So the response is easily understood by the listener. Yes, sir. Yes, darling is conceivable. But yeah, sir and yeah, darling is unthinkable. So nobody uses any suffix along with the word okay and also with the word yeah in America. So you just have to utter those simplest short words and the meanings are understood by the listener. Coming to the next paragraph. The refinements of usage in countries where English has a bazaar status are worth a study. So we have to analyze the usage of English in countries where it has a bazaar status. Common men use English in those kinds of countries. On a London bus, you will never hear the conductor cry, ticket, ticket. So in London bus, they never say, ticket, ticket. But what do they say? They approach the passenger and say, thank you. And on receiving the fare, again say, thank you, sir. So that is how they respond in London. So if they want ticket, they don't tell you directly ticket because it is British English. They don't approach you in direct English. They will say thank you and then you have to give the fare. Once you give the fare, then the person, the conductor again replies saying, thank you, sir. I found out that one could calculate the number of passengers in a bus by having the total number of thanks heard. So to each person, he will go and say thank you two times. So to calculate the number of passengers in the bus, you just have to take the half of the number of thank yous that you have heard already. In any Western country, if a receptionist asks, can I help you? It really means, have you any business here? If so, state it. So they are not saying it directly in a Western country. So they may seem very polite to you. They may ask, can I help you in a polite tone? But then what may be their intention? Their intention may be, have you any business here? If so, state it, quickly state what is your problem. Or it may mean, evidently you have wandered off into a wrong place, go away. So it may also mean, do not disturb me, just go away from here. A man who wants to pass you always says, excuse me, while he may with all justice burst out. So somebody who wants way, and if you are blocking his passage, then what does he say? He says, excuse me, but he may say it very politely, but in his mind, it may not be that polite. He may be wanting to burst out. What do you mean by standing there, by gaping at the world while you block everybody's passage? So that may be his intention, but his intention is does not reflect in his language. His language may be polite, but then you have to understand their intention from these expressions. Stand aside, man. When you send your card in, the busy man secretary appears and whispers in your ear, "Would you like to wait?" Again, it is another polite expression, but through the tone of one's conversation, you have really no choice in that manner. From the tone of a person's conversation, you cannot actually make out what is he intending. So that is the kind of ambiguity that is caused by British English. So you have to understand that and respond accordingly. The thing to do is not to answer the question, but say thanks and look for a comfortable seat in waiting room. So you don't have to directly answer there. You just say thanks and then go from there. Coming to the next paragraph, that is the conclusion. The time has come for us to consider seriously the question of a Bharat brand of English. So R.K. Narayan throughout the essay has described about the variances of American and British Englishes. So in the conclusion, he says that the time has come for us Indians to consider seriously about the question of a customized Bharat brand of English. So far, English has had a comparatively confined existence in our country. So far, till 1974, till the period of his writing this essay, English had a confined existence in India. English was used only in certain fields like the halls of learning, justice or administration. It was not used in daily, day-to-day conversation. Now the time is ripe for it to come to the dusty street. So everyone should start using English. So that is how the language has to change. So it is not a foreign language now for us. So it is our language. English has become our language, and it is not the British English that we are using now. We have to form our own English, which is called an Indian English, that is a Bharat brand of English. English must adopt the complexion of our life and assimilate its idiom. So idioms are used by native speakers. They are very fluent in English, and so to enhance the quality of their English, they use idioms and phrases. So we also have our proverbs and our idioms in our regional native languages, in our mother tongue. But we have to build our own idioms in our Indian English, and we have to enrich the Indian English. I am not recommending that we should go back to the days when we heard, particularly in the railway, "Where you going, man?" British English will respect the rule of law and Bharat English will respect the rule of law and maintain the dignity of grammar, but still have a Swadeshi stamp on it. So that is the idea that R.K. Narayan has about the Bharat brand of English. The English that we use in India should definitely respect the law of English language, and it should have the dignity of grammar. So those rules should not be changed, but then we should incorporate the certain stamp, certain Swadeshi stamp on it. Certain cultural connotations should be added into the language, and it should be enriched into a English that is specifically for Indians. So it should be like the Madras handloom check shirt, which you get only in Madras, and the Tirupati doll, which you get only in Tirupati. So our English also should be like that. It should be specifically for the Indians. So for that variant, people have to come only in India and receive it. So I hope it is clear for you. Now let us discuss the glossary and also reading comprehension questions. Here you have the glossary, certain difficult words that have been used in this essay. First one is toasted, which means, when do we use the word toasted? You eat bread toast. How do you make the bread? You make it brown and crispy by heating it by using a toaster, or you put it on a pan and then heat. Okay, that is the process of toasting. So here R.K. Narayan used the word toasting to talk about English language. So he is referring to the changes in English language. He is not actually toasting the bread here. He is talking about toasting the British English and changing it into American English and also Indian English. Next is muffin. Muffin is a small cup-shaped bread. Next is formalism. Formalism is giving extreme importance to outward forms or rules. So Britishers give extreme importance to formalism. They are very particular about the rules of English language. But American English, when compared to Britishers, is very casual. Next is stifling. Stifling means suffocating kind of feeling. So the English language in Britain has the stifling tyranny of passive voice. But then America has got rid of that stifling tyranny. Tyranny means oppressive use of power. Next is ceremonious. Ceremonious means excessively formal or polite. Next word is chuck. Chuck means to throw someone out. R.K. Narayan uses this word chuck when he is talking about the key word check that is used in American English in different context. Next is insinuation. Insinuation is an indirect hint. Next one is sibilant, that is having or making a hissing sound. The sounds produced by snake and the sounds produced by certain letters like s, z, sh. You get that z kind of sound, the snake sound, hissing sound. So that is sibilant. Next is mongrel. He is talking about mongrelization. Mongrelization means crossbreeding. He is talking about crossbreeding different languages. So mixing varieties of languages indiscriminately. I hope the new words are clear for you. We'll go to the next slide where we have the reading comprehension questions. So question number one is, American 2 went through this phase. Why does the author use two? Which other country is he referring to and what did the country do? The author uses the word two as it is not only America but other countries also who have gone through the process of throwing out Britishers from their country. After throwing the Britishers from the country, they have retained their language, that is the English language. Even India has done the same. English is the second official language of India. Next question, that is question number two. Much of formalism has been abandoned. According to the author, in which country does formalism surround the use of English and in which country has it given up? According to the author, in British English, there is much of formalism. However, in American English, they do not use formalism anymore. They have changed it into a more direct, casual variant of English. They have got rid of passive voice also. They are more clear in their use of English language. Next is question number three. In the first paragraph, the author directly and indirectly refers to the use of English in three different countries. Which are the three different countries? You'll be able to answer. It's a very simple question. He's talking about Britain, he's talking about America, and also he's talking about India. So these are the three different countries. Now question number four, how was English changed in America as a result of toasting? So one noticeable result of toasting is that formalism surrounding the use of English language has been abandoned and they have freed the language from the tyranny of passive voice. They have evolved at certain keywords that can be used apart from the dictionary use of the word. They use it in different context. Next question, that is question number five. America freed the language from the stifling tyranny of passive voice. Where, according to the author, does the tyranny still persist? The tyranny still exists in Britain, who uses British English. Even in India, majority of the Indians follow British English. So we do have that influence of formalism in English and also the tyranny of passive voice. Question number 6. In a similar situation, a 20-line inscription, does he actually mean this? If not, what does he really mean? He doesn't actually mean 20 lines, but then he means Indians also follow British English and they are likely to plant a board that uses formalism and passive voice a lot. Now, question number 7. In the second paragraph, the author contrasts the use of English in America with that of another country. Which is that country? The writer contrasts American English with British English. He says that there are a lot of variants in the use of both Englishes. Question number 8. In all, how many American keywords does the author mention in the third and fourth paragraphs? Author mentions around 4 American keywords. One is check, which can be used in different contexts, and the other one is fabulous. Third one is okay, and fourth one is yeah. Question number 9. In the third and fourth paragraphs, the author discusses the use of English in which countries? He talks about the use of English in America in those paragraphs. Next, question number 10. In London, bus, ticket. Where will you hear this and why? You will not hear it in London, but you hear it in place where English has a bazaar status. 11th question. What are the expressions such as thank you and excuse me examples of? Both the expressions have more purpose than the dictionary use of language, than what they actually mean. When the conductor says thank you, he is actually asking for the fare. Similarly, when somebody uses excuse me, they are not being polite in any Western country, but they are actually asking you to move out from their path. Next is question number 12. Who, according to the author, has used English so far in India? According to the author, in India, English has been used in the halls of learning, justice and administration. So I hope you enjoyed reading this essay Toasted English and you have got lot of information from it. Read it and practice the comprehension questions. Try to write a summary of your own. Okay. Thank you, students. Thank you for listening.